Man,
why don't you play something sweet?
Because everybody wants it hot, that's
why. Lordy, no, they want it sweet.
All right, then, play it sweet and hot.
I've got to have music. All's a matter about music. But the music has got to be sweet and hot. Got to be sweet.
Got to be hot.
I've got to have girlfriends. All's a matter about girlfriends. But the girlfriend has got to be sweet and hot.
Hello. So I figured out why not start this one out playing some music instead. So that was a piece by a fellow called Jack Teagarden from the 1930s or 40s, a song called Sweet and Hot, which sort of describes the way people would have described their popular music in the 1930s and 40s. We're going to talk today more about jazz music, and we're really going to talk about the idea that there were different things people got from that music. And when we talked about New Orleans jazz last time, and we talked about that very energetic improvisation-based style of New Orleans jazz, I mentioned that some of the people, when this music came out, referred to that early jazz as hot jazz. And hot was a very important part of jazz music in the 30s and 40s. But the other idea was they also did like sweet jazz. They liked things that were slow songs that had lovely melodies because those lent themselves well for slow dancing and things like that. And today we're going to really talk about how jazz thrived during the 20s, 30s, and 40s, which is that period of American popular music when it was the most popular music. So let's go ahead and talk about some jazz. And you've perhaps heard some people refer to the 20s and 30s as the jazz age. That's a term, I think, from F. Scott Fitzgerald. But it is, in a sense, appropriate to think of this era as being a new age in American history, not just of, you know, popular music, but also of a lot of different things, because it's during this era of the 20s and 30s that we find there's going to be a great shift in cultural mores. Mores here just being a word that means sort of the accepted standards of behavior and what's, you know, what's right and wrong to do. Well, in the 1920s and 30s, a lot of those things are going to be changing, and people are going to be having different ideas about what's the appropriate way that men and women can behave. And a lot of these changes in cultural mores are going to be brought about by new attitudes people have because of the fact that people live their lives in different ways, due to the fact that American society is going to change at this time, and also due to the fact that technology is going to be really changing people's lives in the 20s and 30s. And for some of those reasons, you probably already know what those changes are because you talk about them in just good old American history class as well. But I think it's important to talk about them here as well, and to maybe link them more directly to popular music and popular culture of the time. One of these changes due to technology is one you can probably think about. It's going to be the presence of electricity in people's lives, the idea that electricity becomes available. The light bulb is invented in the 1800s, but it's really in the earlier decades of the 20th century that we're going to see electricity becoming widespread. These are the decades where people suddenly start to have electricity in their houses and in the buildings in their towns and things like that. And it's more of an expectation that it will be available than it won't. And of course, you know, that means that they can light things up brighter at night, they can stay out later, they can do things like that. And of course, the fact that people have electricity in their homes and that there's electricity out and about has some pretty strong ramifications for popular music and popular entertainment. Now there are radios. People can like hear music being broadcast on the radio. They don't just have to go to a live performance to hear a piece of music. They can hear a recorded performance on a radio, which means that they're no longer looking at just the things that existed before then. Live performances, phonograph records like Victrola records that you would wind up, or piano rolls. But now there's a radio and you can click it on and hear the newest, most current music. And you can hear it broadcast in the evenings. In these days before television, people would gather around their radios in the evenings and listen to things. There's also, people would go to see movies. And movies often featured popular musicians performing or even starring in the movies. And as I mentioned in our last video when we were talking about the change in singing style in the jazz era, and I mentioned that this is the time when the singers who we call crooners come about. I mentioned that they were dependent on microphones. And, you know, electricity is one of those things that's going to make it possible for music to change a bit. Now we can amplify instruments. So they can actually play louder music for larger crowds because they didn't just amplify the voice with microphones, but things like guitars get amplified, and that, of course, makes life a better thing to live. So that's another thing that happens is, you know, electricity is a technology that affects everybody's life in this era, and it certainly affects music. Of course, you know, another technology of the early 20th century that's going to change things quite a lot is the fact that automobiles arrive on the scene. And in the 20s and 30s, we're looking at that era when automobiles become available to, you know, more people. They become more affordable and they're produced more widely and stuff. So, you know, this means people could go out and travel and go farther from their homes. They could maybe stay out later at night since they had faster transportation than walking or riding a horse or something would have been in the older times. So, and of course, the other thing about an automobile too is it means that when couples were dating and things, they no longer had to like stay at the house of the girl's parents, perhaps, or had to stay where people could be supervising them, that they could perhaps, you know, go off alone in their cars together, and, well, you can imagine what happens there, which I guess sort of leads to the whole thing about not every change in this era happens because of technology. Some of it happens because attitudes change, and that's certainly going to be the case in the jazz age. There are attitudes about what's the right way for people to behave, what's appropriate behavior, and people are changing their minds about what that is in this era. People have new ideas about how should people interact with one another, and these new ideas are especially changed up when it comes to women. You know, and the ideas about, you know, what can a woman get by with doing and not be scandalous, those standards are going to become very different in the 20s and 30s than they were in the era before. The way women express themselves, the way women present themselves, going to become different. And just to illustrate that, let me show you some pictures of how women dressed before and then during the jazz age. A lot of times we call that end of the 19th century the Victorian era, and it's, you know, it's a word that's almost synonymous with repression and strictness to some people. But these are some magazine pictures of ladies' fashions from the Victorian era. And you can see these dresses are very frilly, but they're also, they cover pretty much everything that could be covered, and they're very cumbersome, and they have these huge bustles on the butts that would be in there, and, you know, the dress goes all the way down to the floor. And even if you were a child, like that poor child on the left side there, you were basically expected to dress like a miniature adult. Here's another one of those drawings from a different magazine, but I've included it because, you know, look at those incredibly high necklines that were the things women wore at the time, and you can see the bustles on, especially on the two ladies in the drawing on the left side there. And the boots that they would wear would be those very high over the ankle lace-up boots. It was a very binding, restrictive type of fashion they wore. When we move into the jazz era, that's going to change, and we're going to see a new character emerge in history. and that female character is what's referred to as the flapper, sort of the good time party girl of the 1920s and 30s. And you know, here we have a photo of, you know, some women in typical flapper wear of the 20s and 30s, and you can see it's quite different than those Victorian costumes we were looking at in the slides before this. You know, the skirts are much shorter, scandalously shorter, some people would say, in the 1920s and 30s. The shoes are no longer the ankle boots. You know, their arms are free. And these, you know, part of why these clothes look this way, of course, some of it's, you know, based on the idea of shifting mores and the idea that, you know, women feel more free to show more of themselves and to dress more uninhibitedly. And part of it's also because of the music they had. You know, the music they had was this hot jazz, this fast, energetic, syncopated music that people, as I mentioned a couple of videos back, that people liked to dance to. And the dances they did were different than the dances people did in the 1800s, where the dances were very formalized, dances like the waltz. Or if you've ever seen the Gone with the Wind movie and you see the scene where they're having the dance and they're all dancing the Virginia reel and none of the people who are dancing together actually touch. You know, the dancing in the jazz era changed. You know, couples had physical contact during dances, and the dancing during the hot jazz, the fast music, would be very, very physically demanding and stuff. So this type of clothing lent itself more to that type of stuff. Likewise, those short bobbed haircuts they had were preferable because that way their hair wouldn't get down in their eyes when they danced or anything. They wouldn't have to worry about whether their hair stayed up in its proper Victorian bun or anything like that. So, you know, it's a new era to be, certainly a new era to be a woman in the 20s and 30s. And, you know, it's also a new era to be like a pop music consumer, because you're going to be used to hearing your music not just in live performances, but you're going to be used to hearing it through radio broadcast, played on jukeboxes. You'll see it in the films when you go to the movies and stuff like that. And the music you're going to be experiencing is going to be this new energetic jazz music, which we, you know, have discussed when we talked about the beginnings of New Orleans jazz. And one thing that early jazz had in common with ragtime is that it had a little bit of an uphill battle to gain acceptance. It was an uphill battle for ragtime to gain acceptance because, A, it was an African-influenced music, and not everybody was wild about African culture. And B, the ragtime music was often played in whorehouses, so that sort of gave it a bad reputation. And that was also the case with Dixieland or New Orleans jazz. You know, it originated in the Red Light District in New Orleans. It had an association as being sort of a wild and immoral music. And when jazz started catching on, there were people who had complaints about that. And of course, you can see how their complaints are going to be not just about how the music sounded, but also about how the people behaved. You know, these women rode in cars alone with men and stayed out late and dressed like flappers and showed their legs and did these wild dances where they touched each other, and it was all a bit much. But a lot of times when people were like making the case about how the world was going to hell in a handcart, they would use the music as the example. Case in point, what I'm going to show y'all on this next slide. This is a memo that was released by something called the Illinois Vigilance Association in 1922, in the days when jazz was starting to really gain acceptance with a wide audience and stuff. So, you know, I want to read this because it's got such a great headline up there. "Jazz Ruining Girls," declares reformer. And we'll hear exactly how they're ruined here, because moral disaster is coming to hundreds of young American girls through the pathological, nerve-irritating, sex-exciting music of jazz orchestras, according to the Illinois Vigilance Association. In Chicago alone, the association's representatives have traced the fall of 1,000 girls in the last 2 years to jazz music. girls in small towns as well as the big cities, and poor homes and rich homes are victims of the weird, insidious, neurotic music that accompanies modern dancing. The degrading music is common not only to disorderly places, but often to high school affairs, expensive hotels, and so-called society circles, declares Reverend Richard Yarrow, superintendent of the Vigilant Association. The report says that the Vigilant Society has no desire to abolish dancing, but seeks to awaken the public conscience to the present danger and future consequences of jazz music. That the weird, neurotic, sex-simulating strains of so-called jazz music result in a feeble-minded morality is indicated in a study recently completed by the Illinois Vigilance Association. Mid the distracting notes of the saxophone and the weird beat of the tom-tom was witnessed conduct not hitherto seen outside the old red light district. In full view of the audience, which included many boys and girls apparently still in their teens, couples on the floor gave way to almost every form of indecency. Dancers violently threw their arms around each other, frequently assuming immoral postures. Lights were lowered, and the strains of syncopated music action that are indescribable took place. This is the full flowering, the fruition of modern erotic music, which is so craved and befuddled the moral makeup of young people. Well, ain't that something? So, this is quite a little article to read, and you know, the thing that I hope you took note of is that the thing that's being singled out really in this article, above all else, is the sound of jazz music, which is seen as leading to all the other problems. You know, the article makes a point that it's not anti-dancing, but it blames this new jazz music as resulting in a feeble-minded morality. And it says that, you know, when it's describing all the inappropriate things couples are doing on the dance floors and stuff, it's sort of seeing them all as being the problem caused by the sound of jazz music, which it does refer to as syncopated music. And actually seems to think that syncopation and that driving beat have the power to make people give up their self-control and give themselves over to these wild, lusty images. So, and of course, you know, the thing that's probably even better too is if we could see the dances that were taking place then and see what people were doing, we would probably think there was nothing at all inappropriate about them given what we're used to seeing in 2020. But go back almost 100 years and the mere fact that a couple on the dance floor would be touching each other in something other than a very formal dance like a waltz or something, and especially the couple on a dance floor might be having very close physical contact during a sweet jazz song, a slow dance, that would be more than some folks could handle. So let's talk about the type of music people wanted when they were like doing these crazed erotic dances and when they were like giving themselves over to these wild passions that the Illinois Vigilance Association was so worried about in 1922. And here, of course, is a picture that I showed you all when we first talked about New Orleans jazz. Remember, this is what the earliest jazz bands would have looked like when they were in the infancy of jazz, New Orleans jazz or Dixieland jazz, we call it. And you've got your jazz band there, which is a rather small assemblage of people, featuring two main elements, the so-called front line, which would be the three men standing in front here, going from left to right, the man playing the trombone, and then the man playing the cornet or the trumpet, and the man in the suspenders playing the clarinet. And then in addition to them, you have a rhythm section that's added in, which includes the drummer and the stand-up bass player and the piano player and the banjo player, who are all around the back row there. And of course, the rhythm section's job is to keep the beat, that's the drummer, play the bass line, that's the bass player, and then be able to play chords and fill in the harmony, which is what the banjo and the piano are doing. So That's the first jazz, Dixieland jazz, or New Orleans jazz. When we move into when we move on into the 1930s and 40s, we're going to see that people start expecting a bigger group. In fact, I showed you all a picture, I think, in the last video of the Paul Whiteman Orchestra, and we saw how it had moved into what they call a dance orchestra in the 1920s, where you had some of those instruments we would expect in the New Orleans jazz band, like drums and clarinet and stuff, but where we also saw that he'd added in violins and more musicians to have a more big, more lush sound. Well, in the 1930s and 40s, that's going to get standardized. The next era of jazz music is really what's called the swing era or the big band era. And part of why it's called the big band era is because the bands get bigger. Let me show you how much bigger. This is a picture of one of the big bands, or one of the swing bands. I go back and forth on what to call them. This is the Count Basie Orchestra. And if you look, you can see that there's a considerable amount more going on in this picture than there was in that picture of the New Orleans jazz band on the slide before. We see some of the same instruments. Like, I see there's a piano in this one, like there was in the last one. There's a guy playing the drums, see way up there on the upper right-hand corner. The guy who should have stood a little bit closer on the far right, who got cut off, that's the bass player. So there's our rhythm section right there, right? Chords, keep the rhythm, play the bass line. And then if I'm looking at all the guys seated in the middle there behind Count Basie standing at the microphone, then I can see some instruments I might have in a New Orleans jazz band. Like in the very back row, I see trumpets. And in the next row down, I see trombones. If you look in the very front row, something that this band has is it's got a saxophone section as well. And the big thing that makes a big band is this. Basically, it takes the instruments that would be frontline instruments in a New Orleans jazz band, and instead of having just like a trumpet or a clarinet or a trombone, it has sections of them. You can see there are like three trombone players, well, four trombone players and four trumpet players here, and I guess five saxophones seated down there. So that's what makes the big band big, is now we have sections of instruments. Oh, and those four guys on the left in the back who are just sitting back there without instruments, those would be the singers. And that's a pretty standard big band lineup, because here's another picture of a big band or a swing band from the 40s. This is the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. Tommy Dorsey is the guy standing next to the piano there with the trombone. He was one of the best trombone players of the era. And you know, a lot of these bands are led by a person who is an accomplished player on one instrument or another. Like if I had a picture of the Benny Goodman Orchestra up here, you'd see Benny Goodman with his clarinet out there. But this is Tommy Dorsey, and he's a trombonist, so there he is with his trombone. And you can see that he's got basically the same setup that the Count Basie Orchestra had. He's got a rhythm section, piano, drums, bass. They're all down there on the right side. And then he's got sections of melody instruments. He's got four saxophone players in the front row, and then he's got three other trombone players in the second row, and he's got four trumpet players seated in the back row. And then standing at the very back, he has five singers that mix male and female voices. And here's the Duke Ellington Orchestra. And one thing to notice, now that we're looking at Duke Ellington and we've just looked at Tommy Dorsey and we've just looked at Count Basie, is notice how these publicity pictures all sort of emphasize that jazz is not a particularly integrated musical style in this era. Basically, all the guys in your jazz band are white, or all the guys in your jazz band are black. It's pretty much the way it works at this point. But if you look at, you know, Duke Ellington's lineup in terms of instrumentation, you'll see that, you know, regardless of what color the guys in your band are, they're all going to be playing the same instruments now, because we've got our rhythm section instruments, right? Duke Ellington standing on the left side there in front of the piano he'd play. And then in the back row, you have a drummer and two bass players. And also notice sitting down next to the piano down there is a guy with a guitar. So that's your rhythm section. And then all those other men seated in the chairs are playing the melody instruments. There's a section of saxophones in the front row. And in the second row back, you've got your trumpet section and your trombone section. And I want to listen to what this music sounds like. And since I've got Duke Ellington up here, let's listen to a Duke Ellington song. This is a good song because it's actually about the music and stuff. I mean, what the lyrics are about is, you know, what the virtues of this new jazz style are. It's a song called It Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing. And swing is sort of another way to describe the musical qualities that happen in jazz music. Just, you know, it's actually a little bit of a more hip term than saying syncopation or something like that. But the swing refers to the beat that's created. Some things to notice in this song before we listen to it also, some worthy aspects. Duke Ellington wrote this song, and he's one of the songwriters from this golden era of songwriting we were talking about in the last video. So in addition to writing really good songs, we're going to find that he tends to write his songs in the same style that George Gershwin and Cole Porter and those guys like to write in. And the preferred style, not the only one, but by far the preferred style, was the Tin Pan Alley style, the four-part AABA format. The other thing to notice in this particular arrangement, a lot of times what people talk about with Duke Ellington is the arrangements that the bands played on his recordings and how they're very, very clever ways that he used the instruments. And you'll notice that in this song, there's some vocal imitation that happens in the A sections because there's more than one singer. And when I'm talking about vocal imitation, what I'm talking about is basically, you know how when you're in music class in like fourth grade and they're trying to teach you to sing around, so you sing Row, Row, Row Your Boat and everybody starts at different times. You'll have one half of the class going Row, Row, Row Your Boat gently down the stream. And then as they go on, the other part of the class comes in later going Row, Row, Row Your Boat. That's imitation. It's one part imitating what another part just did. And this song has an extended instrumental section at the end too. One thing it features is call and response. And it's call and response of a neat way because it actually emphasizes something that we're going to notice in big band music. When we hear New Orleans jazz music, we're hearing a lot of improvisation. We're hearing stuff that's mostly improvised. When we're hearing big band jazz, there's still a lot of improvisation, but since the instruments play in sections, there's also a lot of writing things out in music notation and expecting them to read a part and play it the way you'd expect a musician in a classical orchestra to read a part and play it. So, you know, pretty much anytime you hear like three or four people play the same thing, that's probably not improvised. But when we're going to hear this, you're going to hear sections of horns play these little things like bum, ba-da-da, bum, bum, ba-da-da, bum. And then there'll be like a single instrument, like a trumpet, or this particular version, he's actually got a jazz violin player in there, who will play a response to it. So it's that call and response idea we hear in African music. So let me play this for y'all now. Here we go. Here's section A now.
Don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. Do I, 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 do I.
Here's A again.
It don't mean a thing. All you gotta do is swing. Do I, 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 do I.
And here's B.
Makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Give that rhythm everything you've got.
And here's A again.
Don't mean a, don't mean a, don't mean a thing.
And here's another call and response. And here's the response. Okay, so you sort of get the picture of how this stuff goes. It's a little bit of a different sound than what we hear in New Orleans jazz. And of course, since it's happening about 15 to 20 years later than the recordings we heard of Jelly Roll Morton and Louis Armstrong and stuff, we're hearing a little bit of a better recording quality too. I don't know if you can tell that with me playing a speaker and recording it on my computer, but when you listen to the Spotify playlist, you'll certainly notice that the recording quality there is a little bit better. And I want to look at another representative big band of the 1940s. In fact, I want to look at the most popular big band of the 1940s. For some reason, a lot of popular music textbooks tend to skip over these guys, but this is one of those times where I'm just going to decide, well, let's really assume that the popular and popular music means something. And let me show you all the most popular best-selling band of this era. This is the Glenn Miller Orchestra. From a period of like 1939 to 1943, were the bomb.com of big band swing and stuff like that. And you can see Glenn Miller standing down there in front conducting his band, and you can see all of the instruments, right? The saxophone section, the trombone section, the trumpet section, the rhythm section down around the back there, and then the five singers standing around in the middle. Glenn Miller's standing there holding his trombone, which was the instrument he played, but he wasn't necessarily a performer of the level of Tommy Dorsey or Duke Ellington or Benny Goodman as a clarinetist or anybody like that. Instead, his real knack was as an arranger, as a person who actually either wrote original compositions for or made arrangements of existing compositions for his band. Because the thing that made the Glenn Miller Orchestra so successful is they had a sound that was all their own. It was very, very unique, and it was something listeners latched onto. It's a sound that doesn't really have as much improvisation to it as we'd find in a performance like the Duke Ellington Orchestra we just listened to, or as you might hear with somebody like Tommy Dorsey or Benny Goodman. Glenn Miller Orchestra was a little bit more conservative. They certainly had plenty of great guys who could play great improvised solos in the band, but a lot of times they really emphasized these great arrangements. And I'm going to play a recording now for you that shows you that. This was the Glenn Miller Band's signature song, a song Glenn Miller wrote called Moonlight Serenade. It would be the song that they signed on to and off of their weekly radio show with, and it would be one of the songs that they recorded, and it's one that really characterizes their sound, which is a super sweet sound. In fact, this is a ballad, a very, very slow song, so it's an example of sweet jazz, but there's this sound Glenn Miller got by using the clarinet and the saxophones and combining them to take the melodic line, and he also does things like he uses little things on his trumpets and trombones called mutes. In fact, you can see some in the picture there. You can see like those hats sitting around the trombone guys, or you can see them up next to the trumpet guys in the back row. Those aren't things the guys would wear. They would take them and they'd hold them over the front part of their instrument, the bell, and it would make the instrument have a more nasal sound. And he basically kind of painted with the different timbres you could use in a jazz band. So here's the Glenn Miller Moonlight Serenade, or here's part of it. Oh, and it's written in AABA form. This is the first A section. See, he switches the sound from the clarinets to the trumpet. And here we go through the second A. Section B. trumpets take the cello. Now here's the clarinet. And now for this last A section, he's going to let the trumpets be trumpets. It's got this nice big sound at the end. So, excuse me, didn't mean to start it again. So you sort of get the picture of what the Glenn Miller sound was like. And it was a sound that definitely took off and served them well in the 1940s and stuff during their heyday, because people wanted to hear this. They wanted to buy these records. They wanted to play these records on the jukeboxes and the places where they would hang out. They wanted to listen to this on the radio. And the Glenn Miller Band was so successful at selling records that they got the first one of these. 1942, for their single Chattanooga Choo Choo, their record company awards them the first gold record because they sold more than 100,000 copies of Chattanooga Choo Choo, which was quite an accomplishment in 1942 when there weren't that many people and not everybody bought records or had a record player at their house anyway. So they were recognized for record sales with this gold record. And, in the 1950s, the recording industry is actually going to start awarding gold records. But the idea first happened with Glenn Miller's record label in 1942, where they realized this guy's selling so much music. We should acknowledge that. That's how they made their money back then. The money was in selling recordings, getting paid for live performances, maybe getting paid to appear in a movie. Glenn Miller and his band appeared in some movies, as did Count Basie and his band. And the other thing a lot of these bands did to make money is when they played live, they would have like a regular gig at the same place over and over again. Count Basie's orchestra played at the Cotton Club in Harlem. The Benny Goodman Orchestra played in New York City at the Savoy Hotel, which is why the Benny Goodman song I've put on the listening list for y'all is called Stompin' at the Savoy. They had sort of a song they played in honor of the place where they had their home base. And I want to look at a Glenn Miller Orchestra song that sort of pays homage to the Glenn Miller Orchestra's home base, which was the Pennsylvania Hotel in New York City. This is a song called Pennsylvania 6-5000. As I mentioned, the Glenn Miller Orchestra had a standing gig at the Pennsylvania Hotel. That was one way that they generated their income. The other was they had a weekly radio gig called the Chesterfield Hour, where people would tune in the evenings and listen to them. But the reason this song is called Pennsylvania 6-5000 is because what Pennsylvania 6-5000 was it was the phone number of the Pennsylvania Hotel. If you ever watch the old movies from the 40s, whenever somebody wants to make a phone call, they don't push buttons or dial or anything. They just pick up the receiver and they go, "Operator, get me Northside 777," or something like that. Well, if you wanted to call the hotel where the Glenn Miller Orchestra played, you would say, "I want to call Pennsylvania 6-5000," and they would ring up the hotel. And the thing that makes this song such a pop music song is that it's so caught up with the then and now of the early 1940s when it was made, because this is a time when telephones are becoming more and more and more commonplace, but they're also still sort of a newfangled invention in the sense, they were invented in the late 1800s, but it's something that people are getting more and more available to them in the early half of the 20th century. So this song that conspicuously talks about phone number, by doing that, that sort of makes people know, well, this is a modern song. This is not like a parlor song from 1820. This is not a classical song by Bach from 1720. This is from our day and time. So there's that. It's about an actual real thing, the Pennsylvania Hotel where the Glenn Miller Orchestra played. And it's got some technology in the recording, because one of the gimmicky things about the song is you actually hear the telephone ring, and then everybody yells out the phone number of the hotel, which is sort of some good free advertising for the hotel, because one thing musicians have done throughout the centuries is basically suck up to the people who pay us. You know, in like the 1600s, it was kings and princes and people like that. In the, you know, in the 1940s, it's the hotel ballroom that gives you your nice weekly gig. So, you know, imagine if, like, you know, 20 years ago, Nickelback had done a song that was like, you know, LaQuinta.com or something like that. That's sort of what's happening here. Is, you know, the Glenn Miller Orchestra is, you know, paying a little bit of tribute to their employers. But let me play this song for y'all, and I'll flash up what's going on the screen as it plays. So here we go, and I will put the sections by as it plays. So that's for this intro. And notice what we're going to hear next is an AABA design. Saxophones take the melody. That smooth Glenn Miller sound. And
Pennsylvania 6-5-thousand.
The gimmick. And then here's the A section again. This is section B. Now back to A. And now we've got an instrumental section of these improvised solos. The trumpet goes first. One of those properties of music. And unless they're using it now, they're going to start adjusting their volume and getting a little bit louder. So when we're hearing stuff like the Glenn Miller Orchestra or like Duke Ellington or Benny Goodman or Tommy Dorsey or any of those guys from the swing band era, one thing to be aware of is that you're hearing jazz music from the era when jazz was the most popular it ever has been. That's when it was the, you know, undisputed king of popular music. When people thought about popular music in this era, they would think about big band jazz. That's what people listened to. You know, it had been accepted by audiences by and large. You know, those worries that the Illinois Vigilance Association had in the early 20s about, you know, was this, you know, syncopated, sex-crazed music driving people to lewd behavior? By the 1940s, that's all sort of passed over a little bit. And, you know, audiences like this, that's what they go for. And Certainly you'll find no better example of a group that has great success with swing music than the Glenn Miller Orchestra. In fact, you know, the end of their story, it's a little bit of a bittersweet story, is that Glenn Miller kind of gave it all up at the height of his career, because in 1943 he enlisted in the Army. You know, he wanted to do what he could to support the effort in World War II, so he gave up his big band and his radio show and took a job conducting an army band in Europe, and his plane disappeared over the English Channel, and that was the end of him. The end of the actual era of big bands is going to come in the next decade, in the 1950s. Part of it because, you know, tastes just change as time goes on and people want to hear something different. But part of it also probably for economic reasons. You know, think about how many mouths you would have to feed if you were Glenn Miller or Duke Ellington or somebody like that, and you had those bands. That's a lot of people to feed. 4 trombone players, 4 trumpet players, a rhythm section, a section of saxophones, all those singers, and you know how much singers eat. So, you know, it's really hard to like make a musical organization like a big band profitable. And especially, you know, if you think about touring with a group like that, you know, you've got to get everybody on a bus. And it's so in the 1950s, jazz is going to make a couple of different changes. One is it's going to move to a smaller design for the bands. The groups we're going to see are going to be smaller. And the other thing is the way the music functions is going to be very, very different. As I said a couple lectures ago, with early 20th century jazz songs and stuff, the audiences that listen to it saying, this is music for dancing. I mean, we hear it also, but they sort of, when they were looking for pop music, what was good popular music, they were like, well, what's danceable? What can we do a foxtrot to or whatever? In the 1950s, the way jazz is going to present itself is different. It's going to actually become listening music more than dancing music. And the first song I'm going to play for y'all here by a guy named Charlie Parker is really going to illustrate that. So there's Charlie Parker on the saxophone on the left side there, and the guys in his band. I don't actually know the names of all the guys in his band. But if you look, you can see that it's a much smaller affair. It's basically just Charlie Parker on the saxophone there, and then he's got 3 guys in his band. There's the string bass guy standing on the right side there, there's the piano guy, and it's not may not be apparent to you, but the guy at the very back against the wall there between the piano guy and Charlie Parker is sitting at a drum set. So it's basically just Charlie Parker and a rhythm section, right? Drums, piano, bass. And they're playing a Duke Ellington song, or an arrangement of a Duke Ellington song called Coco. But they're not playing it the way Duke Ellington would have at the Cotton Club in like the 30s or 40s, where they would play it in such a way that people could get on the dance floor. But instead, they're playing it in a way where they really get to show off their instrumental chops. And this has a trumpet player along with Charlie Parker, a guy named Dizzy Gillespie. But listen to this song. Notice in particular how fast the tempo is. And think if you could actually imagine people dancing to something where the tempo goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this does. I'm gonna let it pause there so we can talk about it. This Is Not a Fast Song, featuring Miles Davis on trumpet and John Coltrane on saxophone, but it's a very moody, sort of atmospheric jazz song called So What. Starts out with a bass solo, and it's a very cool song, but it's also very indicative of the sound of bop or cool jazz. And there are a lot of instruments here, just a rhythm section, drums, piano, bass, plus trumpet and sax. Bass solo, bass solo. Definitely cool, no doubt about that. But it's also definitely not Pennsylvania 65,000. It's not a song that's necessarily meant to be danced to first and foremost, and it's not a song that's judged by, is this a good dance song that audiences will like? It's also a very long song. That's about an 8-minute long song, whereas most of the songs up to this time tended to stay at or under 3 minutes. So that's one change. And as I said, the bigger change is that this sort of represents a shift in how jazz music functions. And in the 1950s, jazz music isn't necessarily seen as the king of popular musics anymore. You know, in the 50s, rock and roll is going to emerge, among other things. And country is also going to be a more popular style of music in the 50s with a larger audience. But, you know, jazz certainly has those decades in the middle of the 20th century where it dominates, and you can see it start out in the early 1900s in New Orleans with that sort of Dixieland jazz band approach with the front line and the rhythm section. And then as it becomes more successful and as it becomes more respectable and more people want to hear it and they want to hear it in more elegant settings and stuff, you'll see these big bands start to arise, and that's where the Duke Ellingtons and the Benny Goodmans and stuff come in. And then when we move into the 50s, you know, the musicians who make jazz sort of change what the aim of the music is from, you know, this is the mass entertainment that everybody wants to dance to, into this is the serious music that we create that we would be happy for people to listen to, but we create it out of a sense of wanting to make the best music we can. Like I say, sort of how classical musicians tend to function in our day and time as well. In fact, you know, one thing about jazz music that sort of maybe underscores how it's not the most popular music anymore is it's one of the musics you can go to college and get a degree in, you know, and that's been the case for about 30 or 40 years now. But let's talk about other things people do when they go to college, by the way, because I said everything there is to say about jazz. But, you know, one thing that people do when they go to college is they take tests. Oh boy. And that would be you all on Monday, June 15th, I'm describing, because that's when you have your second test. So let's talk about what's on it. It's going to be similar to the last test. It's going to focus on primarily what we've done since the last test. So what we've done from ragtime on through jazz. But don't think that you should have lost all familiarity of what went on in the 19th century. You still need to sort of understand what parlor songs and chorus songs and minstrel songs were like and what they maybe had to do in, you know, paving the road to ragtime and jazz and things like that. So the first part of the test is going to be some listening. There'll be four of them. And I think what I'm going to do, I might embed it in the test on Google Forms, or I might just give you Spotify links on the test, and you can open them and listen to them. There will be one question that's similar to the last test. I'll play a song, and you'll hear it, and you'll say, it'll be a weird arrangement. I'll play, like I might play a Glenn Miller orchestra song, but play it done by a heavy metal band. And you would say, huh, well, that's weird, because usually Chattanooga Choo Choo is a big band swing song with a rhythm section and saxophones and trumpets and trombones, and here we heard it with a screaming singer and a distorted guitar, you know, or something like that. So I'll ask a question that sort of works your ability to talk about what the right way to hear a song performed in its original era would have been versus what we're hearing there. And then the other three questions will just be multiple choice listening questions. I'll put down like four different musical styles. Like I might put down ragtime song, a jazz era song, minstrel song, parlor song, something like that. And then you'll listen to the musical example and you'll click which of those four styles it represented. So you need to know the difference between what a big band song sounds like and what a New Orleans jazz song sounds like, or a piano rag, or a cool jazz song. So that's the first part, the listening. There are four. The next thing's going to happen is there are going to be some short answer and true, false, and multiple choice questions. And that's really going to be a lot of the test, probably most of the test. And the final part is going to be an essay. I'm going to give you perhaps four questions, and I'm going to want you to choose one of them to write the essay about. So, and that's probably where it would be really important to make sure that you still remember things from the first section of the class, because I might ask you to trace the history of how songs developed from the parlor song up through the time of George Gershwin and Duke Ellington. So you'd need to sort of be able to talk about, well, you know, parlor songs were strophic and didn't have any repeated texts. And you'd say, but then there were minstrel songs that had refrains, and then the choruses started getting bigger at the end of the 19th century. And then by the time you get to the 20th century, we get these songs where the chorus dominates so much that people don't always even play anything other than the chorus of the song. And it'd be really good to be able to put examples of songs we've studied there to support your case. Like you might say, you know, for instance, My Funny Valentine. You know, most of the times when we think about that song, we only think about the chorus of the song. We don't really think about the fact that there's this introduction that leads into it. Or I might ask you about, you know, singing styles. You know, how did they sing in the 1800s versus the singing style by the time we get to the middle of the 1900s? And it's going to be due by the end of the day on Monday. So you've got all day Monday to take this. You're not going to need all day Monday to take this. You should be able to do this in an hour or two at the absolute most. And, of course, I'm here on email and stuff if you all need me and have questions. But take care of yourselves till then, and happy test taking. So long.